I will be really very, very brief. I won't go through everything, through all the subjects, but I would like to point at some very few questions in which I would like you to bear in mind. One, perhaps the most simple of all, which is so simple that usually it goes without mentioning it, is where does economic science stand in the branches of science? What are its most close relations with other fields? So we give two kinds of answers to this question. One is totally extrinsic, looking at the branch of sciences from outside and just putting together those fields that seem to have a certain affinity in their subject matters. Then, if we have time, we'll come to another approach which is more profound and more interesting, which comes as a consequence of the full development of economic theory. The big picture I'll give you now will change somewhat, but this first idea, this first drawing we will make in the next few minutes is enough to have a first idea, and try to not to get lost in the little focus we make on certain subjects when we start analyzing economic categories. So how can we draw a very big picture without any previous theoretical development? With imagination and using metaphors. So our metaphor here would be some geometric devices, and think of a hollow cone where you have to put a set of spheres. You have a collection of spheres which represent different fields of science, of research and knowledge. You have a cone into which we want to fit them. Where would you start, with the biggest one or the smaller one, or just at random take anyone? If you want to fit them all into the cone, which would you get? The smaller. Okay, so we start with the smaller one, then we put all of them, and the cone was designed so as to fit, to enclose all of them. Now, just take one more or less of a middle size. They have different diameters. We take one of middle diameter, average diameter, and we'll represent political economy in that sphere. So political economy will be connected upwards with larger spheres and downwards with smaller spheres. If we go upwards, the next one would be economic science. Now, we are making a difference, which is not usual, between political economy and economic science. We will say that political economy is comprised within economic science. What do we mean by this? Economic science is the study of the economic structure and relations of human societies, whatever their degree of historical development. One of these stages, or one of these chapters of economic science, is specialized in one particular historical economy, which we call capitalism. So this first approach should tell you to keep in mind that all our categories in political economy have a double dimension. One is specific, the other is generic. Now, if we still go further upwards, after economic science, we would find larger spheres where economic behavior is also studied, but not specifically related with human societies, but with biology. And this larger sphere is usually called ethology, which is the study, the scientific study, and we are already standing midway between social sciences and the so-called, and the badly called, natural sciences. So we are already building a bridge between these so-called sundered off from each other fields. Of course, after ecology, after ethology, we would go on with ecology, and we enter directly into natural, so-called and badly called, wrongly called, natural sciences. So let's go back to the middle-sized sphere and go downwards. And this is our point. This will be our main focus of interest. Because political economy is, we will argue, composed by three theories, which have the same kind of relation of growing diameter relation we already saw outside, above, in our representation, above political economy. Do you follow me? Yes? Okay. As we go downwards, we have to make another, an important distinction, because these spheres belong to, or represent economic theories belonging to political economy. What we are saying is that the whole economic theory that bears upon capitalism is composed of just and only three general theories. And of course, we are making still another distinction between theories, between economic theories and economic doctrines. This is a most, most important distinction, which is usually looked over. And it won't be easy for me to say in two words what the difference is between economic theories and economic doctrines. But I can ask you a few questions, and you will see that you already have an intuition or a certain idea of this difference. If somebody defends very hardly, very closely, his position against an enemy, if I hold my ideas with a certain kind of closeness against the alternative position, would I be upholding a theory or a doctrine? What? A doctrine. What is the difference? Theories have the purpose of furthering knowledge. Doctrines have the purpose of keeping the true faith. There's much more to say about this, of course. We're trying to put complex concepts into very small nutshells and go on, because we can't click here long enough to make this clear enough. Nevertheless, I think that this first idea should help us to say something more about how doctrines and theories are related in the history of economic thought. What we usually call history of economic thought is not the history of economic doctrines, but the history of economic, it's not the history of economic theory, but the history of economic doctrines. There is no Chinese wall separating doctrines from theories. Doctrines enclose theories for their ideological purposes. Theory is developed throughout modern history as a captive of ideological doctrines. And the progress of science, we can depict it as a gradual but very complicated and contradictory process by which theory becomes more and more liberated, sets free from doctrine. However, theory thus is not able to develop by its own self, so it starts with a very simple doctrine, which is in the lowest point of the cone, which studies the market. Of these three general theories, the first one, counting upwards, which means to say the one that is right where the cone is pinched into the table, is what we call catalactics. If you want to have a rapid idea, think in neoclassic economics. And the word economics is a proper name, it's not a general name, it's not the name of a theory, but the name of a doctrine. It was invented, as you know, to differentiate catalactics from political economy with a doctrinal purpose. There were several names propounded. One of them was economics, which was a word that was invented for the occasion. And the name we have adopted for this first general theory is catalactics. Catalactics studies the market, and this is the first general theory where modern scientific economic thought started in the lower Middle Ages. But catalactics, once it is developed rigorously, suffers an implosion. And this is, even if you want, funny or tragicomical, because the moment in which you develop the theory enclosed in the neoclassic doctrine, if you take this theory and develop it rigorously, it comes to what seems nothing. It reaches a point where upholded was impossible. It becomes impossible. This is perhaps the most difficult part to understand. Just take it at face value, as I say it, and I hope to make this clearer in a word. But the problem is that catalactics was meant to demonstrate that markets behave autonomously and have an enclosed, stable equilibrium. But to demonstrate this, to reach a really rigorous demonstration, was as it was presented by Léon Waldra in the turn of the 20th century, it happens, an accident happens, and to demonstrate the autonomy of commodity exchange, commodity has to be assumed away, and the autonomy has to be assumed away, and an extraneous character has to be put into the field to make it possible to reach that state of equilibrium. So, in this sense, this first theory fails. And this is why many people, especially in the left, say, well, that is rubbish, that is not scientific, we have nothing to do with catalactics, let's start all over away from a different angle. Well, they are wrong. Catalactics does leave an important result, which has nothing to do with what it expected, but it will give us the precise definition of what we should understand by market equilibrium. The authors, like Waldra, are so wrong about what they found. They made a discovery, but they don't know what they discovered. They don't know what their discovery is about. And so he calls it general equilibrium. But far from being general equilibrium, this is only market equilibrium. Market equilibrium by itself is, as he himself demonstrates, is not possible. If there is any chance of demonstrating a general equilibrium, the market has to be enclosed in a larger set. Here we come back to our cone, and we have to move a step upwards from catalactics, and we enter what we call APE. The name may sound rather funny, but it's, APE is not an animal here, but I don't know how you say in English, a word composed of an acronym of abstract political, abstract political economy. Why abstract? Well, we'll see in a while why we say it's abstract. But the little picture we had before of the market is now part of a bigger picture, which is the reproduction system. And this is where the famous and most problematic concept of value appears. We'll manage for the moment provisionally with an extremely simple definition of value. What do we mean by value? First of all, we have to say that value, as most economic categories, has, as we said before, a double dimension. One dimension makes carries the determinations of capitalism. The larger generic dimension belongs to a phenomenon to be observed in any human society, capitalist or non-capitalist, and even in animal societies, where we can also observe the phenomenon. What do we mean by value? The word value means, alludes to a property that belongs to reproducible goods, and only to reproducible goods, by which these in a determinate quantity and quality represent a determinate quantity of social labor. Immediately, we may be asking for simple instances, for simple examples. One most simple example used by David Ricardo is a man who, in his technical capacity and on his own past experience, knows that in 1 week work, he can manufacture either one jacket or four hats. For this man, we can call him Peter, if you want. For Peter, these two objects, which are heterogeneous, they are two objects of different quality, so we couldn't compare them quantitatively. One is a jacket, the other object is composed of four hats. Just imagine these two things. Well, for Peter, these two so different things represent the very same thing, which is his work during a week in normal conditions, which is the work that would be necessary to reproduce, to bring back one of these goods. This is the simple, generic concept of value. However, things get very complicated when this simple, generic concept has to be applied to a very different setting from Peter and his isolated experience. And we suddenly find ourselves in this very complicated picture, which is capitalist economy, where nobody knows the value of his own products and nothing to say of the products of others. Value is unknown, and yet we have to explain that value determinations have a practical effect on the general movement of the system. This is the problem that APE has to solve and solves quite elegantly, and we won't dwell upon this right now because our time goes off, but perhaps in the second or third hour the thing may come up. But we have to go on, and the problem with APE is that it threw the baby with the water used to bathe him. Historically, in authors like Smith, Ricardo, Marx, they didn't receive a well-developed catalactics because there was a time mismatch between their time and this development that happened almost simultaneously with the publication of the first edition, German edition, of the first tome of the first book of Das Kapital. So there's a mismatch, a disencounter, that leaves us victims of confusion. We haven't inherited, we haven't received the right theory to enjoy what we can call an updated economic theory. However, one of these three authors I mentioned came very close to a third theory, of which we can say just a few words, but we will, and we'll try to point at the most important. And this is what what Marx called the form of value. This passages where this author expounds this really epochal discovery are rarely understood. They are written in a rather confused style, and many of his disciples in the next century, which was the 20th century, just didn't look into this because they didn't think that it was there where they had to look. So the Disencounter goes on and becomes ever more dangerous. What happens in this first chapter or first section of Das Kapital? Commodities, I'll say it in my own words, and I won't discuss the difference between my present interpretation and the one we find in Marx, because then again, this is a question to be discussed with more time. But I would like to insist that you will be welcome if you want to keep on with this discussion at any one of the points we so rapidly pass over in this moment. But to make a very long story short, what happens is that each and every single commodity, once it the very moment in which it becomes a commodity, demonstrates that commodities are impossible. I'll try to explain this, because I agree that I'm speaking in a very funny way and very shocking. I say that commodities demonstrate they are impossible. It really must sound very shocking and very displeasing, if you want. But I'll try to show you that this is something important, and this was really a discovery. Let's go back to the very point of the cone where the first subject matter of what will be political economy and economic science be, and this was the commodity. The commodity is something like the point on which the whole science of this whole economic science of capitalism is based. And what is a commodity? Commodities, as I said before about all economic categories, have a double dimension. They are specific and generic. Their generic dimension is this so simple that what we call commodities are goods, are exchangeable goods, goods that are exchanged in a large social setting. Never before capitalism, this setting was so large as to be worldwide, but there was social exchange since very, very old times, and perhaps since the inception of human societies. There is some kind of exchange also in animal societies. I think there are no zoos anymore, but if you see in television a group of monkeys, a group of elephants, of savage dogs, lions, you will see that there is some kind of exchange between them. And sometimes this exchange is very subtle and very complicated, and we can guess the appearance of what will be future cultural institutions in these non-human societies. But human societies are not conceivable without some kind of exchange. There are very different kinds of exchange, and one of them is the market or commodity exchange, which has very special, very specific traits that are exclusive of a commodity. To instantiate this, to make an example, we can compare commodities with another kind of social exchange, which is the gift. There is a beautiful book by a French sociologist, Marcel Mauss, which is called An Essay sur le Don. The don is a kind of exchange which is the opposed from commodity. In the don, in the gift, the man who gives the gift shows the other part that he is inferior socially. And the gift seals a social relation between the two parts. It implies some kind of counter prestation, but this is absolutely forbidden to be made expressly. Just think of this. We have examples in our own modern society of gifts. If somebody goes to your birthday and gives you a nice present, and you say, well, how much do I owe you? You would be offending your guest, wouldn't you? But if you go to the market and ask what is the price of this, you are supposed to pay that price, and there's no secret about it. And once you pay the price, there's no further relationship between these two persons. Because commodity, as different from any other kind of social exchange, is impersonal, is universal, and most of all, is instant. It's like a spark that goes on and off almost at the same time. And the parts involved in this relation were previously isolated from each other and will be again isolated from each other after they establish this strange, fugacious relationship, which is the only general social relationship in a commodity society such as capitalist society is. Commodities are not unconditionally exchangeable, but the exchangeability of a commodity is random. So that the man whose sole possible social relationship is a commodity is a social exile who can only hope to make his essential relationship, which is social. And if he does succeed in making it, the moment he succeeds, he loses and he's back, thrown back to isolation. Yes?
Can I ask one question? I was just wondering whether this is not maybe
a bit... I have to go closer.
Yeah, whether this is not maybe a bit of an artificial idea of commodity exchange, because if we look to, I don't know how business is going, you go to dinner with your business partner and you drink together and you try to establish a social relation to make business work better.
Yes.
So
yes.
That's a bit contradictory.
Yes, it is contradictory. And this is a very important point. I will ask you to hold it for a few minutes, because this is what will come to our next point. But you're right, you're right. This is a fiction, an analytical fiction. But, well, I answer now because we have already directed our attention there. It is a fiction, absolutely a fiction. But let me ask you, could we live without analytical fictions? No, you can't. Could you count?
No.
Could you say a word without an analytical fiction? Could you say window? Because if you say window, you're assuming an homogeneous collection of objects which are reciprocally identical. We couldn't use any word. Perhaps, yes, we could use proper names. I spoke about Peter a while ago. Well, we could say Peter. And we could point at something. This is a deictical definition. Peter! I know you're not Peter, but it's just an example, please. I'm not attempting against your identity. But yes, it is a fiction. Well, theory works with fiction, and the art is not to get fixed within fictions, not to hypostatize, make these fictions metaphysically real as subject, as substances. They are not substances. They are just passing ideas which we need to communicate. We construct all the time. We couldn't say a natural number if we don't assume that all the objects around us pertain to homogeneous classes, which is absolutely untrue. So if you say, no, I don't accept the number three because I never... Okay, that wouldn't make sense. Yes?
So basically a doctrine would be a fiction that is enclosed within itself?
Pardon?
A doctrine would be a fiction that is enclosed within itself, so that is not open to like basically develop any further...
Please repeat it.
You said that theory... Any theory is a fiction, but the important part is not to get fixed within
yes,
the theory.
Yes.
So basically a doctrine is a theory that is fixed within itself and just like working
yes.
within its own framework and thereby inherently making itself contradictory in the end.
Yes, because theories, this is another point that should come afterwards, but I'll try to answer it. Well, I'll give up trying to be systematic because what are theories? We have an economic concept of concept. We have an economic concept of theories, which is very simple, and it goes like this. By what we call knowledge and all the instances of knowledge, we are producing. This is a field of social production like the one that makes your wristwatch or your bottle with water, your shoes. These are products of a certain branch of industry. Theories are the product of a general process by which we manufacture, this is not the right word, but to keep the comparison, we manufacture experience. Experience is not just given to us directly by the senses. Sensations are processed by means of cultural process. of which I can also give you an example, and you will understand this very easily. Just imagine for a moment that by art of magic, we call a very remote ancestor of us, of anyone of us, to come into this room and tell us what does he see. We can point at any object, and he doesn't have the cultural perception of what a desk is. So perhaps the answer will be something close in his cultural experience to a desk. I don't know what it could be. Perhaps a trunk of a tree, a fallen trunk of a tree. I don't know. But we are all the time producing experience in different levels. Theory is that level of this branch of production where we try to acquire a general, relevant, coherent, synthetic knowledge, or let me take this word off, knowledge, organization of our experience. We wouldn't have any practical capacity in a modern society without theory. So the prejudice against theory, people that say, oh yes, okay, that's only theory, but we want hard facts and practice. Well, they are simply prejudiced, ignorant, and they think in a very dangerous direction for us all. Does this answer your question?
Yeah, of course.
Okay. Shall I go on with the back to commodity? Okay. Then I'll keep on trying to be systematic after all. Okay. So commodities come to the market and they cannot be what they are supposed to be. What are they supposed to be? They are supposed to be only aleatorily exchangeable, only conditionally exchangeable. But as here comes what Marx discovered. When a commodity actually becomes a commodity, this is when it is announced in the market and offered in exchange of something else, this something else is converted, which was a commodity for his owner, is converted into something that has the direct opposite properties of a commodity. Because this, Marx calls it equivalent. This second commodity that should be also only conditionally exchangeable becomes unconditionally exchangeable. So this, if we develop it conscientiously and rigorously, will blow down all what we have developed, all we have expounded up to this point in Catalactics and Ape. Now, Catalactics and Ape, considered both together, are two general theories. Indeed, the second theory encloses the first theory, so they can be considered as one single theory that conceives capitalism abstracting from planning. Capitalism is bereft, deprived of planning. Why? Because the all its members have only a single kind of relation between them, which is commodity, which implies the conjunction of two free wills by a perfect contract in which neither part can impose a condition. Okay? So, Peter, and let the other part be called Paul, Peter and Paul. Peter offers four hats in exchange for a knife. Well, this exchange is absolutely voluntary. Peter has no way. Perhaps Paul, having a knife, might have a chance of imposing his will upon Peter, but this is an accident of the example I took, and it's a bad joke. Forget it. But there is no possibility of power, and so commodity in the 18th century philosophy is part of a general view of modern society in which all economic relations go on in an enclosed sphere where power is exiled from, and this is called civil society. Power is outside civil society in another sphere, which is called the state, or the political society. However, coming back to our accident, when commodity, when it turns out that commodities are impossible, what we acknowledge there is that it is impossible to exhalate power from civil society, which means that not only commodity will be impossible, but civil society will be impossible. And with the impossibility, with the self-contradictory character of civil society, all our illusions, which are not of the kind we were... What is your name, please? No, you...
Magdalena.
Como?
Magdalena.
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 Magda.
Como?
Magda.
Magnes.
Magda.
No.
Magda.
Magna. Magda. Okay, Magda. Well, this is not the fiction we were speaking with Magda. This is another kind of fiction, which is not an analytical fiction, but an ideological fiction. What stumbles down with the, when we find out that commodities are impossible, that civil society is impossible, a second theory stumbles down. Never mind, because it will be replaced by a third theory. But something else stumbles down, which is the ideological construction that idealized the state as a perfect modern state, which was the incarnation of general will and the guardian of social needs. Well, this is shown to be also impossible. Let me say it rather brutally. This means, this will take us to find out that democracy is incompatible with capitalism. I'm going too fast because this is just a rapid drawing to draw the big picture, but this is what will come out here. And here I pass to the last point because I'm afraid my time went off already. I'll be very brief. I'm sorry I used the whole hour. I wanted to be to leave more time for you. Just 5 minutes, okay? Well, the second point I want to make is the difference between notions and concepts. Notions are a halfway house between ideologized common ways of thinking and feeling and concept. Concepts, I already tried to give you an idea of the economic concept of concept, or the concept of concept as an economic concept, when I told you that human societies of all kinds are all the time trying to put together in a coherent and administratively and susceptible to be administrated knowledge, which of course is therein resides the capacity of a society to change and to confront all different kinds of problems. Ancient societies and archaic societies had their own coherent cultures, and they already solved the problem that we can't solve, but they solved it for isolated particular societies. And if we want to make the long story short, what we need, under condition that if we don't accomplish it, we are not able to change replace capital by something else. What we need is to have such coherency, but organizing an experience of a cosmolytic, of an universal, complex society, which poses problems altogether different from ancient cultures, which solve their problems with magic, with religion, with myth, and also different from bourgeois ideology, which tried to solve the problem by metaphysics. The problem with Marx is that he is not sufficiently free from metaphysics to go on from his discovery forward. So he leaves it there. It's a curiosity in the style of this book that the difference in style between the first section and, the first and second sections, which are the four first chapters of Das Kapital, and the fifth chapter on, which is back to Ricardo and back to flat thinking. So this difference between notions and concepts, and I finish with this, makes a very great difference when we come to speak of research in the field of economic science or in the field of political economy. Because there are two kinds of research. They both deserve to be called scientific research, but it's very different, very difficult to improve received notions than to transform concepts into new concepts with big consequences. Full stop.
My name is Lilian, and this is Sukriti. And we are bringing one interpretation of the paper. We are mainly focusing on the two topics that Professor sent us in the email. So it's not covering all the paper, but it's one of the interpretation and some points that are interesting for discussion. As an overview, we'll firstly talk about the contributions we found interesting in the paper. Secondly, about the distinction between economic theory and economic doctrine. We do the same with political economy and national economy. And we'll try to explore a bit and have more questions actually than answers to WWDTP. So regarding the contributions, we found it is a specific way of organizing history of economic thought. Professor Levin is very worried about trying to define how theories respond and how they treat these three categories, commodities, capital, and money. And after that, he tries to define core concepts that unite them, and you have already seen in the paper and here today. After that, he presents a very interesting critique of the political economy, which he has just done. And it's a way to understand why political economy did not lead to socialism. And his definition of political economy is that it should lead to transformation, but it failed to do it. And after that, it comes the question about socialism and how could we should think about it. We'll explore more of these points during the presentation. So, firstly, it might be a little bit repetitive because we are going also to talk about the definitions, but we thought it would be interesting to bring a definition from the dictionary because, as we just talked, sometimes these concepts are not as clear as we think they are. So, theory is a formal set of ideas. No, sorry, Ed, because sometimes these concepts are not as clear as we think they are in our heads. We think we know what theory and doctrines are, but actually they are mixed up. So, theory is a formal set of ideas that is intended to explain why something happens or exists. Doctrine is a belief or a set of beliefs held and taught by a church, a political party, or etc. From these two definitions, what we tried to interpret is that doctrines are the way theories emerge in society, is the way they are applied and interact with society and history. And because we believe there is a dialectic relationship between the both, so the way theories, doctrines are applied in society must also bring something up in changing the way theories are developed. And this is an interesting link to explore how we theories evolve. Sorry. So Professor Levin is worried about a history of economic thought. And in order to do this kind of research, you need to have in the back of your head an answer to this question, how a methodological approach to understand how this happens. So different authors respond to this in different ways. Sprecante and Zang Magini tried to make a summary of the ways you can answer this question. And incrementalist is basically that each theory adds a bit for the previous one and is a more smooth process. The other one is catastrophic, it's based on Kuhn, and it's basically that you have big revolutionary periods in which the basis of the dominant theory are questioned, and then a new group of theory emerges. And you also have Lakato's research programs that is more worried about how theories inside a research program evolve. So it's basically close to the incrementalist. And these authors think it's not very good to apply Lakato's research program to economics. So after reading professor's paper, we thought it's a mixture of both incrementalist and catastrophic, in the sense that he's trying to identify what each theory brings and adds to the other one, but also what is the threshold between them. And basically we identified that it's the answers they pose and they cannot answer. That is what gives space to a new group of theories. And these are mainly the points that he already explored, but he's trying to separate these different groups through the paper, so I'm not going to talk more about it. So after thinking about all these definitions and the way theories evolve, we were questioning ourselves, so what is the role of ideology? So we have Dobb, he defines ideology both by its delusive character, so as a lens that prevents you from approaching reality as it is, if there is something we can call really reality, because no one can see them. And also the historical relative character of ideas. So a man is always a product of his own time, and this certainly affects the way he thinks about society. Schumpeter has a similar approach, and he says that ideology is the way one sees things, and he's very critical to Marx in this sense, because he says that Marx criticized the ideologies of his times, saying that they were full of capitalist ideology, but he couldn't see ideology in his own theory. And to Schumpeter, it's impossible to have a theory that has no ideology. And then Schumpeter says that people's ideas are likely to glorify the interests and actions of the classes that are in a position to assert themselves, and therefore are likely to draw or to imply pictures of them that may be seriously at variance with the truth. And this little quote shows the effect of ideology in theory building, because then we have everything that we have today as mainstream that is kind of a picture of this effect. So, we designed this little chart here because for us, after thinking about this, we tried to understand that ideology is something that is always in the back of a theory. And then you have the theories and the doctrines are the product of these theories in society, and also these doctrines and the way they evolve when they are applied will transform theories. But even if you have this dialectic process, ideology is always behind. And if you think about what happened after the crisis, that mainstream theories, the doctrine was surely failed, but mainstream theories aren't changing that much as they should, it's because there is an ideology behind it. And Professor Levin says that scientific socialism endeavor as first of all seriously aspiring to set workers free from ideology. So one of the questions we would like to pose is, can really a theory be free of ideology? Because if one defines ideology as the way one can approach the reality, everyone has an ideology behind it. So I'll pass the microphone to Sukriti.
Okay, next, as Professor Levin had sent us in his email, we also wanted to look at the difference between political economy and national economy. Professor Levin defines political economy as the science which focuses on studying a capitalist system or a capitalist society. National economy, in our interpretation of the paper, basically refers to the way political economy is practiced these days. Whenever we form policies or whoever is using and applying economic theory always localizes it to a certain context. So it's that's what we probably, a professor could correct us later, but we were was our understanding of what would mean by national economy. And the problem with this is that because we've narrow down the theory so specific to a certain localized context, it becomes harder to change it, or like it becomes immune to transformation. Next, Professor Levin in his paper explores some of the failures of political economy. The first one of the things he says is that the way political economy has been structured basically has been in terms of capitalist terminology and capitalist concepts. So our understanding of the economy and of society is within these terms. So he says that even what this does is it narrows our imagination in trying to think of about alternatives about how to transform, because we can only think within these concepts that we know, and these are all favored in terms of a capitalist society. Secondly, political economy as such does not give us a path to transformation. It does not tell us how to get there. So we could take the example of China. For example, China did have a communist regime, but it still followed a capitalist technique of production. And that is why, like today, China, I mean, it suffers from many problems which you can see even in other developed, capitalist countries. And yes. Finally, the concept of World Workers' Democratic Transitional Planning, which we would also like you to tell us more about after about WWDTP. But of course, within the paper, the three main concepts Professor Levin talks about within this is one of, firstly, of conceptual autonomy. That is, basically, we should, he says that the existing concepts that we have to understand society do not lead to transformation. So we need to change the way we look at the existing concepts that we have. We need to broaden them and probably have some new concepts. Then he talks about differentiation of capital. Now basically, there's this thought within political economy that there's a tendency for equalization of profits to happen, and professor gives us the example of, there's a temporary window when firms can make profits, and then after that, the other firms start imitating, and then finally, you know, competition kills profits out of the system. But what professor says that there is always a hierarchy that exists even within capital, and some firms do have an advantage, and this is obviously true. Like, you can see large MNCs obviously have more advantages than small capitalist small firms. And we would also were saying this, the same thing is also that within the labor there is a differentiation of the labor class, of the working class itself. I mean, there are some who are more privileged than the others. And then he talks about capitalist planning. What we understood from it was that the way our society is structured and is in terms of the power groups have, right now the elite have control about how our society actually gets structured, which is in favor of the so-called capitalists. But to actually achieve transformation, the workers would have to play a larger role in determining how you can structure society. So workers' planning would have to play a larger role. And you also explore the concept about international socialism versus national socialism. Again, what we understood from the paper was that you're trying to say that because there exist so many hierarchies within the labor and capitalist classes, we don't have a global vision to see how we could transform. And what we need to try to understand is how all the workers in the world have a relation with all the capitalists, and this kind of global vision would be necessary for a transformation to happen. And probably that is why our experiments with being not capitalist, maybe like say in China, failed, because China was also a part of a bigger international system, but it just tried to find a national solution. We want to ask you, how far do you think are we currently from achieving this? How far are we currently from achieving, transforming? And can we really ignore?
At this hour.
Yeah. And secondly, can we actually really ignore a national interest right now at this stage of development to have this kind of international vision of socialism? And also, would just theoretical solutions, would they necessarily lead to the required institutional changes that would actually help us transform? Would theoretical solutions be enough?
Yes. Wow. too many things, really. It was very interesting. I hope I'll have a tape afterwards. Is that possible? Because I'm afraid I'll miss quite a lot, but you're here to remind me if I miss something. There's only one aspect I want to object to. This was mostly in Lillian's exposition, which is the sources used to define concepts. I have nothing against the Oxford Dictionary. I have other enemies. And on the contrary, I really admire this dictionary. And let me tell you, I find it very helpful, especially for us people that sometimes have to speak in a foreign language, which is not our natural language. So, hail the Oxford Dictionary. But that is not a source where we can look for concepts. I don't think we should look for concepts by quotes, using quotes by famous authors. You rely on Schumpeter, for instance. Words have meanings in different contexts. And the words used to expound concepts for us, especially refined and complex concepts, are impossible without words. But words keep changing their meaning as they go through different contexts. So, especially this happens in every field of science. For instance, I'm sorry, I didn't want to step on your toe. For instance, the word force. Force is quite a common word. I don't think I'm so impressive, but it's quite a common word. But the meaning it acquires in Newton is very different from the common meaning. So if you want to understand the law of gravity, you wouldn't go to the Oxford Dictionary. And this brings a confusion. And because you start thinking from very different angles and new points of departure. And we have to acknowledge the necessity we have of giving new meanings to the words we use. The word value we used before, we offered a passing definition of what we understand for value at that point. The meaning of the word value will change in the third theory, will not be exactly the same. And when Vilfredo Pareto tried to read Marx, he complained because words in Marx for instance, a mouse became a bat. And they really, words suffer transformations which are necessary. So we couldn't make concepts because these transformations in meaning keep the continuity of a discontinuity, which is another of the items you touch, whether research is continuous or discontinuous, or you use another word, more dramatic. Yes. Catastrophic. Yes, yes. It would be enough to say discontinuous, but really it is catastrophic. The downturn of catalactic is catastrophic unless you don't hold to catalactic doctrinarily. For the doctrinary, it is catastrophic, and he will do every possible thing not to reach that point where the theory stumbles and implodes. The theorician, on the contrary, will look for this exhaustion of a theoretical formation because he knows that is what he's looking for. So when we spoke before of the difference between research that betters notions and research that transforms concepts, it would be rather silly to feel that we have to choose between one or the other. both are necessary, but the development of theory is catastrophic, as you would say, discontinuous, as I would say. I buy your word, I like it to say it's catastrophic. To reach a revolution, you have the new society has to mature. And this is the same we can say about the concepts. Concepts show their historical nature by having this this characteristic. And a consequence of what we say is that the so exalted critical method fails when it doesn't take into account that the critique of a theory only leads to the downturn of that theory. But as a method of research, the critique is short-legged because it takes you to that point, but not further on. Further on, theory, the researcher, has to go back to the roots, which are common thought, which are doctrine, which are unscientific. And here we come to the problem of what Oxford Dictionary and Schumpeter say about ideology. They make an enormous mess about it because they don't make the main distinction that opposes and relates dialectically ideology versus science. These are two opposite trends within ideology. Science develops within ideology, and the tendency is to get free from ideology. But then this is, as I said, a branch of production that cannot be developed outside the capitalist institutions. For instance, the university is a capitalist institution. And here we live the dire contradiction between ideology and science. This is, I think, before we use the example of Peter and the rudimentary experience of an isolated worker, but here we can replace Peter by university. The university is an institution that, like all institutions in mature capitalism, are very different from what they say they are. It is supposed that this is the holy church of science. Well, is it or is it not? Yes, it is, but not quite and not only. So ideology and science clash one against each other, but neither can do without the other in the historical setting. So I think this somehow, I don't think I will ever answer your questions, but say something about them, or perhaps show some clue to how to address it. I hope it's useful for you. And you had another one? No. Then we go to the second discussion. Did I pronounce it all right? Yes. Discussion. Yes. Okay. Yes. You showed me something I missed, which was a distinction between political economy and national economy. Well, you worked with that very intelligently, but I don't think we made the point about it already, because capitalism has a history. And throughout the history of capitalism, the capitalist institutions change very radically. One of our problems, and one of the reasons why we don't enjoy an updated political economy, is that our representation of capitalism remains fixed in a certain stage of capitalism. One of the consequences of this is that we cannot consider capitalism apart from certain institutions that are characteristic of capitalism in a certain stage of its development. One of these is the national state. And more determinately, the modern national state. Well, we spoke about the illusion of the national, of the modern state. But this illusion is not just an imaginary illusion. This illusion idealizes certain traits of capitalism, because there is something very, very, which looks very much alike the modern state, in a certain stage of capitalism, where a whole century, which was last century and part of this century, really believed that there could be democracy compatible with capitalism. And the 20th century was doubly wrong, believing that one part of the world was democratic, which was absolutely wrong, and wronger still, do you say wronger in English? I don't think so. More wrong still, they thought that socialism was instated in the other part of the world. You still think that China has something to do with communism, no?
I said that's what I said.
Okay, but it was surprising that that it looked like, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, well, it has been capitalist all through, really, and the same we can say of Russia. This was very early pointed out by some authors, hardly anybody read, but one of them was Tony Cliff, who wrote a book which is really interesting about the Russia. The title is, Tony Cliff was a pseudonym. He was Polish, I believe, but he was exiled in England and he adopted the English nationality, and he wrote in English all his life, and he died just a few years ago. And he wrote a book that was called, you can Google it easily, Stalinist Russia. And this was one of the earliest, not the very earliest, acknowledgement that Russia was a capitalist society, and was the Russian state, the Soviet state, was a capitalist state. The very simple argument of Tony Cliff was that the same happens with feudalism. There are feuds, where the lord holds the lordship on his own right or his family's. But in others, he's a functionary of the church, and he holds the charge in the name of an institution that is impersonal and represents an apostle of God. If that is logically possible, Luther said it wasn't possible also, but it is an abstraction, but it is also a reality. It's a political reality. That it's a very powerful power, a very powerful state that is not national, it's not a national state. And as a consequence of capital differentiation, of which I hope we'll have some minutes to speak about in a while. In the very peak of the hierarchy of capitalist enterprises, of capitalist firms, there are no firms. The capital works without without the institution we can reduce to a political person or to a juridical person. There's no such thing. There's no firm. And there's no capital accumulation. When you say, well, the most powerful firms are the result of centralization and accumulation, this is also false. There is centralization, but not accumulation. There is centralization with de-accumulation. And there are other firms that that stake their capital, and some firms who stake a very wee little portion of capital, and they take away a very large portion of the gains. So when we conceive capitalism, we have to conceive capitalism as transformed by a historical, irreversible process that leaves nothing as it was a short time ago, except our ideas about it. What we learn, we read, we receive as doctrine is the experience of past historical settings. Research means active updating of concepts, stopping at nothing, except the need for knowledge. And you wanted me to say something about that WW and so on. And what do we mean by WW and so on? Please, let's stop at the words. We say WWD, which stands for democratic, T, which was missed in the title you copied, T, which means transitional, P, which means planning. But it's not just planning, but the other letters also. And this is impossible without an updated scientific theory of capitalism. Now, what makes a difference between the image of capital, the picture of capital we can have after we enter into the theory of capital differentiation, and the one we had before, was that the general laws, the general economic laws that you can depict from the viewpoint of the second theory, of ape theory, are laws of adjustment, of a general equilibrium of the reproduction system. The ape theory, the ape political economy, is, to begin with, as I said before, capitalism without planning. Why no planning? Because firms are all alike and have the same power. The world of capital firms is homogeneous. As you said before, if you look at the practical ways of life, there's nothing like it in empirical reality. The laconic way of posing the former supposition was that it was supposed that there was a general law by which the rates of profit, the average rate of profits in all the branches of capitalist reproduction tend to equal. Well, but capital differentiation makes this impossible. There's no such thing as equal, as that equalization. But on the other hand, some firms become powerful and they overload, they overpower other firms, and they plan large sets of firms. So we have subsystems which are planning ambits where large-scale planning is governed by potentiated firms who do two kinds of planning. Here we come again, continuity and catastrophic. Okay, one is continual, which is the recomposition of the subsystems. The other is discontinuous, which is the planning of innovation circuits. Forget about national innovation systems. There is no such thing. Innovation systems are international from their birth, and they are not systems in the sense of a continual process like reproduction is. They are piecemeal, if you can say it this way. And one innovation circuit starts and is finished and claims for planning a reconstruction of the subsystems. If you manufactured an airplane, a modern big airplane in the 19th century, just by having an email by magic picking up all the engineering of the next century, you couldn't fly it, because every innovation has to be accompanied by others which are minor but accommodate structures, enormous structures, permanently to the new technologies. Another distinction we have to make is between technique and technology. But this this is not for this right moment now. So workers are, if they are inspired or guided by outdated theory, they will believe that they have to the way for liberation is to take the state, the present state. If Marxists read Marx and Engels, they would see that these authors, when they observed the experience, when they reflected about the experience of the Paris Commune in 1871, they advanced the conclusion that workers have to create their own state and replace the present state by a new state. In fact, the bourgeois revolutions of the 17th and 18th century did that. The political revolutions came in the moment that the new way of life, the new economic structure, the new culture, the new art, the new philosophy was already there. And the present ancien regime was absolutely became too straight a jacket for the further development of something that was already present and alive. Workers' planning means the same idea. Worker institutions have to be sufficiently developed, don't ask me what sufficiently means, to make a revolution not only possible, because there were revolutions in the past, but they couldn't stand. They couldn't survive the capitalist black hole that pushed them back or pulled them, absorbed them back into capitalism. So the lesson of history is that workers have to create their own institutions. There was an author, which was called Antonio Gramsci, who said this, but this is not an articulate author, so his ideas are sparks, isolated sparks. But he said this very clearly when he commented the experience of the early 20s, 1920s, when the Italian workers in the industrial towns actually took the factories and started them working. And what Gramsci said was that the most wonderful phenomenon, absolutely original to be seen there, was that the workers started creating their own institutions that were, these words are from Gramsci, that were the germs of the future institutions able to replace capitalist institutions. So, in a nutshell, workers' planning is that. Workers' planning comes more or less naturally from the experience of factories self-governed by workers. However, this is not the best situation for workers' planning to proliferate, because, as I say, usually these factories are already in a very bad position. The bosses failed and left ruins. And they have to solve daily urgencies that push them back to a capital accumulation. So perhaps, rather paradoxically, they are not in the very best situation to start planning. And also paradoxically, workers working in prosperous capitalist firms are in a very better position. But then we come against one of the contradictions of the working class, because, as you said before, I think, workers are very heterogeneous. Did you say that? Yes. Did you say that? Ah, she, she. Okay. Yes, they are. But how can you say? The nut of this heterogeneousness is that those workers that want, can't, and those that can't, don't want. You see, I mean, those who are able, because they are qualified and they know the process and they know how to manage the information of the of manage what you study, no, accountancy. Is it so? I know. Who's the accountant? Oh, I'm sorry. I looked for. I'm sorry. Sorry. You hide it behind the head of your compact. Okay, this is what you study. Well, they have to manage this information and re-elaborate it with different concepts. That's the idea. The categories used by your colleagues are not those that we need for workers' management. But we have worked on this, and we have developed. I would like you to have some contact with it, and perhaps you might be interested in working with it. An alternative accountancy for workers' management, which stands upon economic basic theory, which is a chapter of economic theory that usually professional economists ignore, which is capital rotation, of which the second book of Capital is a reference. But I want to come back to nationalism and to Okay. But I have 5 minutes. Yes. No. Here I want to be really, I'll be more catastrophic than you. And there is something really catastrophic to say about national economy, because I'll argue that is the therein lies the germ of Nazism. And this is really catastrophic. At the beginning of the 20th century, there was a downturn of socialism that abandoned internationalism and turned national socialism. And national socialism turned into Nazism. Indeed, the word is the same. This happened in several fields, in philosophy, in political economy that was replaced by national economy, in socialism that was replaced by different types of national socialism. And I'm afraid to say, I'm really afraid, not just a way of saying it, I'm really afraid to say that presently most socialists are nationalists. With a variety of arguments, but this is extremely dangerous. And these three tendencies go together, philosophy, political economy, and socialism. National economy is not political economy. The categories are similar because the words are the same. And if you go to the Oxford Dictionary, perhaps the names you look for come from these tendencies, these doctrines of national economy, of which the paradigm is the so-called, wrongly called, general theory, which is not general and has very little of theory. It does start with accountant categories. Not criticized, just taken as natural facts. And from there on, a representation of national economy is depicted. In fact, political economy was all but abandoned since 1883, which was the year when Marx was passed away. I like to quote, I don't remember if I did put this quote in the paper, a Japanese economist in mid-20th century who said this, after the death of Marx, his followers went on research. There was a lot of research in the sequel of Marx, But all this research had to do with the facade of the scientific edifice which was being constructed, but nobody went back to the foundations. So this is what we are trying to do, and this is the proposal. So here come the questions.
Okay.
All right. My name is Yelena. Thank you very much for the presentation.
Thank you.
I have a question about what you just talked right now. So, like 20, 30 years ago, socialism was very much like people wouldn't like speaking about that, especially after the collapse of the Soviet Union. But now we see that in many countries there are political parties that call themselves socialism. Even like downstairs here in the lobby, you can see the poster with the socialist sign, and it's like socialism seems like it's coming back. So can you answer, are those people mostly nationalists, like you just said? And what motivated the comeback of this idea?
Yes.
Okay, just before you answer, I have to say that in France, socialism means the government we have. So
Means what?
The government we have
yes.
Is supposed to be socialist.
I was going to say that, yes. But I would answer it in another way. Please remind me, did I say something about ideology a while ago?
No, we were just talking that socialism are mostly nationals.
Oh.
Like people.
But I thought I spoke about ideology. Maybe a while before. Did I? Okay. This is my answer. It's a nice name. So it goes very well with something that has nothing to do with socialism, but it looks nice. It's a good robe. The same that when universities are not really universities, the name of university still has the glamour of what it is supposed to be.
But why are there like more and more socialist parties?
Yes, it's true, but this is a dilemma for us. What do we do with our own identification with socialism? Would I say no? If because it's not only Mr. Holland. Mussolini was a socialist, and I wouldn't make a close comparison, but Mussolini was a socialist, and he was a really educated socialist. So again, we have the problem of words. Words have different meanings in different contexts, and ideology uses on its behalf and for its own purposes the very best expressions. What can we do about it? Abstain from using them and choosing another word? That wouldn't help, I believe. So we have to learn that words have a meaning in a given context. And the same vocable, the same utterance, I mean, an homophone utterance means something maybe not only different but the opposite in another context. And well, it is an inconveniency, but let's try to get over it.
Good afternoon. My name is João Pedro. It was very interesting the presentation, and I would like to ask you to talk. It can be a question, but I would like to hear you more comments on the subject. You talked about the commodities, and I would like to talk a little bit about the commodification of the extensive commodification of various parts of the society, especially in the last 30 years. which is, so it's going to sectors of a social life that was never before commodified. As yesterday in a class, a professor told, as an example of property rights over life is one of these sectors, but also healthcare, education, etc., etc. This commodification of society, especially at odds with democracy, as you said, because the commodification means that behind this commodity, which looks like equals part trade in itself, there is lies a production in a capitalist society, which means it's very hierarchical production process. So as you said, capitalism is at with odds with the democracy. In this environment, how would you what would be the limits of our democracy to build for a transformation of our lives? What you would like to, if it's possible, and then it related also with the theme of the names about the socialist parties, etc., etc. But how can actually through this process that it's embedded on this commodification of life to change and transform society?
Okay. For me, it's a very strange word, commodification. It's amply used in, now. It's a sort of a it's a standard word that people use it. Pick it up very rapidly from without opening it and see what it really means. By the word under the label commodification, we find very different things. But one of them is the fact that you can see throughout the history of capitalism that the frontier between production and consumption encloses capitalist reproduction invades the ambit of consumption every day. It started with the textiles in the late Middle Ages. It started with the guilds in the cities making clothes, which was a domestic activity. Now you may choose. There are many things that were only very recently made in at home, and you can go and buy it. There are services. There are ready-made things. You can wash your clothes outside your house. There is the frontier of production is moving all the time, and is enclosing consumption. Consumption becomes that word you use, a commodification of consumption. But the real process is not commodity, but capitalism. Once again we come to ideology. Ideology is the power of capital to enslave your will, your desires, your activity, your ambitions, everything. What can we do against it? Is official democracy? You will be in the polls in a few time, in a short time. Will you have an option that offers a possibility to set free from what you call commodification? I would call the invasion of capitalism. It's not commodity, it's not money, but capital, which absorbs commodity and money, overpowering the state and overpowering that flat and poor democracy, which has nothing to do with democracy. So let's go back to WW and to the first letter, which is democracy. What do we mean by that? By democracy, by workers' democracy, we mean democracy. We mean a system not of representation, not of delegation, but of mandates. Mandate is vincular, is concrete, and has to be accounted for. As I said before, it becomes concrete in a plan. So if you ask me how democracy could face commodification, I would say, if you, once again, the context of the word. If by democracy you mean workers' democracy, yes, it can not only face commodification, but it can do away with commodities, money, and capital. Historically, through a process which is approximate, which is what comes next, we believe, in human history, in human progress. But if you speak of democracy under the present constitutions, I'll tell you, forget about it. There's nothing to do against commodification or whatever you call it. Nothing to do. Of course, you can protest. You can say, I don't like it. You can complain. You can denounce it with your accusing finger. But there's nothing to do about it. Because the question encloses a petitio principi. How do you say that in English? It begs the question, that's the English word. It begs the question of whether democracy is a democracy. If we go to the dictionary, perhaps it will say it's institutions that guarantee frequent polls. But if we want to make this concept as something really significant, we cannot do with that kind of notion, and we have to work on the concept in the right political, social, economic, historical context. And let me say something else about concepts. Concepts cannot be developed beyond the state of institutions of the epoch. There are several authors that in different ways said this. Hegel said that no author can jump over the heads of his contemporaries. And it's true. Marx couldn't. And when Marx found this, made this discovery, not only he couldn't go on and develop it, but he couldn't even understand what it was about. He knew it was something important, and when you read him, you feel the emotion of the author that has made a discovery, but he doesn't know, he will die without knowing what it was. Kant proclaimed he had made a Copernican revolution, and he did, but he never knew really what it was, and he was unable to explain what it was. What do I mean with this? That we cannot develop concepts like democracy just by thinking about it, just by writing about it, just by lecturing about it, but by creating the right institutions. In my view, the right institutions may be depicted by these concepts, which are have practical instance. We do have very rudimentary practice of in workers' planning, very, very rudimentary, but we have some. And this is why we could develop some ideas about it. And I'd like to invite you all in this research, because when we speak of research, we have to have something else in mind. Research is a social activity, not an isolated activity made by a researcher who had a grant or who had some facility to write a paper under very strict and repressive norms. This is some kind of research, but what we need is research, free research, but not only free from obstacles, but developing in free new social relations. That is what we mean by workers' planning.
You were talking of free. Who's to judge what is free? Because if you would...
Please repeat.
You were using the word free in the right institutions, but who's to judge that? Because in the end, if you would ask a capitalist at this point in time, he would say, well, it's the right institution. Everyone is free. Yes. Ideology is free. Okay. Theory is free. So isn't this a conflict within?
Well, who's to judge? Who's to judge? I don't conceive of somebody looking from outside and judging and making the right judgment. Fidel Castro said that history would absolve him. But we don't seek absolvement, but we seek truth, but not just truth of knowledge, not just truth of GNOSC, notional truth, but the social experience in the right institutions. And who is to judge? Well, history. All we can say about them is that if they work, if they open new possibilities, if they counterweigh the tendencies of workers towards nationalism and towards dogmas, towards fundamentalism, and if we find a way of setting a firm floor for international socialism, but not for abstract enunciations, not for abstract statements of internationalism, but the true development of actions and institutions, then we can say, well, this is a criterion by which we can judge if this is right or wrong. Now, can we know beforehand? Can we know, can we be certain ex ante? Yes, we can, but we most probably go wrong.
Hi, my name is Marta. Thanks again for your presentation. Can you hear me okay? Can you hear me?
Not that well,
okay. No, it's a short question. So you talked about...
Never mind. If I came here, don't make it too short. But
okay. Sorry.
It was a long way to
yeah,
come.
Yeah, no. So you talked about the D and the P in your world workers, so on theory. What about the T? What about the transition?
Yeah, yes.
How would that transition happen, and transition to what?
From what to what?
From what to what?
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, transition from what to what? The idea of a transition has its own story. And the leaders of the Russian failed revolution, which, let me tell you, it failed almost right away, they discovered they couldn't pass immediately from very backward capitalism to nothing that could be called a socialism. It was extremely rudimentary. It was supposed that the capitalist economy would be replaced by planning, but the only planner was Leon Trotsky, and what his plan was, what any firm around us here has as a routine, which is, I'll try to find the English word for it, but the routine of revising things if they, to see if they are working. What's the name for that? Pardon?
Trying something, making a mistake.
No, but this is more routinary.
What's the Spanish word?
I don't remember the Spanish word. Mantenimiento in Spanish. Maintenance. Yes, that was the word. Maintenance. What Trotsky did was a program for the maintenance of the railway to Siberia. We couldn't call that a system, a planning system. Years later, under Stalin, a national system of planning was instated in Russia. Some years ago, before the Russian blowdown or downturn, we had a visiting professor who was planning professor of the La Habana University, and she was the relation between the Habana University and the Ministry of Economy in Cuba, and she brought with her the technical documents that they received from the Russian colleagues, guiding the Cuban planning. They were very, very rudimentary, but very, very rudimentary. You couldn't say that was a planning of any sort. And but forget about workers' planning. There was nothing like it. No system of representation, but not even the semblance of a system of representation that you could call, well,
democratic.
Nothing of that kind. But there was an intuition, and the name was created, that a period, a transitional period, was needed to start create the new relations. What they thought, this would last perhaps a few months. But this is where the first idea came, that there is a period of transition, a period when which is by definition quite complicated, during which society is not yet socialism, but not yet, but still capitalist. The extremely complex concept of this period is impossible if we don't have an updated third theory, what we call the third theory, that is, political economy with planning, but the difference is not only planning or no planning, but when we arrived to that stumbling block, which was a commodity that can't be commodity, what comes in crisis is not just the ape theory, but a whole way of thinking, which we call metaphysics. So to conceive the new strategy, we have to solve a problem that was that remained unsolved since the 18th century, which is to set philosophy free from metaphysics. This was announced several times in the 20th century. Positivism was a false announcement of having liquidated metaphysics, but it came out that it was absolutely, they got stuck into worse metaphysics than the one that they had inherited. So this means a new approach to thought. And well, this is what workers' planning is about. And this is what research is about in this context.
My name is Laura Bolívar. My question is also related to the one of commodities.
Pardon?
Yeah.
No, please repeat.
Okay, that my question is also related to the one of commodities.
Okay.
Because during your presentation, you were saying that commodities actually don't exist.
No. I don't say that.
No?
No.
So I understood you wrong, because you were saying that commodities are also impossible.
Yes,
but
that doesn't mean they don't exist.
Okay. And in this line of thought, I would like to know which kind of political implications would they cause if they were adopted as true statements.
Okay. Oh, but please, I never said they don't exist.
Okay, no. Sir.
Well, we just said we have to enter into a new way of thinking. Commodity, in the instant it becomes successfully realized, it vanishes. That is something you have to dance a while around it to understand it. Because if you stand upon healthy common sense, this makes no sense at all. But this is not all. The same finding we have if we want to explain if the working class exists. And we will say the same. It potentially exists, but the moment it will actually realize itself as an historical class, it will vanish, it will disappear. And this was very early said, more or less in these words, by very young Marx and Engels. So we have to stand up to this, and commodities do exist, but their existence is not metaphysic. You see, they are not a substance. They are a rapidly fading process. Does it start to make some sense to you or not? when you get married, you are an unmarried woman. The moment you realize all your that stage, you are not anymore an unmarried woman. You are something else. This doesn't mean it doesn't exist. It means that we have to learn that concepts suffer what Marx again called metamorphosis. but the word metamorphose is a biological metaphor. But let me tell you a little tale. There was that boy who was a boy, he loved to observe nature, and he had a pond in his garden where he observed a little school of small black fish swimming around. One day he went, there were no fish anymore there, but around the pool there were some toads and frogs. What did he think? The frogs ate the fish. No, those were not fish, but tadpoles, who were transformed into frogs. So, do they exist? Well, yes, but they have a vanishing existence, and they enter into a transformation process. Is that okay?
Thank you. My question is regarding alternative accountancy.
Please, wait.
Yeah, I have several questions regarding the alternative accountancy. First one is, on which level do you propose to introduce this alternative accountancy? Will it be macroeconomic level, or will it be the micro level of the entity?
Okay.
And how do you reconcile, if you change one of the system, you need to reconcile the other system because they are interconnected. And another thing is that changing the system of accountancy is quite a big challenge because this system is quite rigid, and all the time, like every time you change something, it has a consequences in the long-term perspective.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Please let me ask you not to feel alarmed. Accountants will keep on doing what they do. This, at least for a transitional period, these two approaches are complementary. Because accountants give standard information which forms part of a legal system. And the this approach I'll describe very rapidly, but I invited you to read, and if you want, we can keep email dialogue. It's not here to solve the rights against the enterprise, against the firm, of the associates of the state or of the debtors, the creditors. This is not our job. We want to measure the rate of, first of all, we want to define scientifically the rate of profit, which accountants do not how to, don't know how to, because they use indices, indexes, which don't correspond to the definition. So we conceive, we take from the accountants, thank you very much, we take the idea of the period of register, call it a year. During this year, we make a database describing each and every transition, active or passive, the firm has made during this period, with its date and with its whole description. I'll go through it very rapidly, but as I told you, the details, we have been working for this both in theory and practice for many years. This we called chronostructure. And the chronostructure, we can imagine it in a matrix where every square, every hole, cell, every cell, yes, thank you. Every cell describes one of these transactions. Okay. this information is charged upon a rotation model, which defines g, small g, which we call the rate of profit, which is in the numerator, you have the difference, you have net income, which is PQ, price quantity, minus the velocity of rotation against compromised capital. But the novelty lies not in the numerator, but in the denominator, where we have divided the numerator by compromised capital. And this means that the denominator is compromised capital, which is a concept accountants don't use. But the intuitive meaning of this is that it measures the stake of capital made by the firm. Because every income comes from different sources. It may be financial credit, it may be commercial credit, it may be the return of circulating capital, or maybe that part of fixed capital you didn't use to replace fixed capital. So we have to know, we make a difference from all these sources and only consider as a denominator those expenses that were made against the own capital of the enterprise. So with this we make simulations, because the idea is that the dependent variables, one of which is the rate of profit, another is the velocity of rotation, and another is the quantity of capital needed for this business, each of them, but the one we are most interested in is the rate of profit. It can only change if the chronostructure changes at some place. So we can measure the impact upon the rate of profit of anything that has any influence upon it, be it the engineering of the firm. Remember that we had in every cell we have P and Q. The Q is moved by production functions, and we can simulate different rates productivity. We can simulate different engineering approaches. And together with the influence of changes in prices, changes in the times, passive and active, in the times of commercial credit, which is usually not taken into account. So this is it.
Well, Pablo, I would like to come back to the distinction between doctrines and concepts and in relation to our daily life as students. We are in a heterodox program, and we have like several heterodox courses which are based on models, and where every concept or almost every concept is put like an equation. And I don't know, just to say a story, we were in a course in which the professor say, well, but we're reaching the point where we have to explain class struggle, and professors say, well, this is really difficult to model. and I pose the question, well, maybe it's not something that is not possible to model. And in this moment, he stopped the discussion and say, no, we are here like studying basic models, so this is not the topic of the lecture. So my question to you is, I will not say. So my question to you is, what is your view about heterodox thinking and its relation with doctrines? What's the
well, my opinion, I'm sorry to tell you, because I know this goes against what not most but all of you think. I don't believe in orthodox, in heterodoxy. Because if orthodox is doctrinary, heterodox is also doctrinary. Because I'd like to come back for a moment to the critique method. It was said, young Marx inherited from what they called themselves in that time, the young Hegelians, the idea, especially from Ludwig Feuerbach, he inherited the idea that was enthusiastically adopted by Marx for all his lifetime, that science progresses through critique. Now, critique meant, in a Kantian stance, something very different as what it means in common language. Again, we have a problem with words. No? In common language, critique is somebody who rejects something and speaks very badly about it. But in this context, in the lineage of Kant, Schelling, Fichte, Hegel, Ludwig Feuerbach, means something very, very different. Critique means expound rigorously till this exposition goes further than the author who is being criticized. So when Marx decided to consecrate the rest of his career after 1848 to research, this is very curious, because he had already announced that there was a science there to found social strategies, but he came to the conclusion, he didn't say so, that science was still to be developed. So he devoted the rest of his life to the critique of political economy, which meant not the rejection, but the very scrupulous development of the main economist in his view, who was David Ricardo. So if you really want to learn to read Ricardo and learn about Ricardo, you have to read Marx, because Marx, as the critician of Ricardo, is the best source for Ricardo. And his idea is to expound Ricardo, which he does throughout his rest of his life and in all his economic works from there on. Is expounding Ricardo till he reaches the point where catastrophic changes have to occur, because what he was expounding became exhausted. And this was not heterodox. On the contrary, it was ultra extremely orthodox. And this is how according to Ludwig Feuerbach, you can set free from the influence of a determinate author, we would say a doctrine. But what we find more than a century after that is that this kind of Kantian critique is not enough for the reasons I presented you when I spoke of the cone with a sequence of theories. Because the critical method is good for one of these stages, but when a theory is exhausted, then you have to start away, you have to get from the ruins of the exhausted theory the only thing that can really help in the next one, which, as I said, was the definition of general equilibrium. And the rest is in biology. Do I have a biologist here? No? The exuvia, which is the old skin some animals take off and leave to develop a new skin. Well, the critique is the right method for a stage, but not throughout the development of economic science. If you want to read about Marx's method, you can read Georgi Lukács, his essay on orthodoxy in Marxism. And he says that if you want to be a real good orthodox Marxist, which is what you call heterodox, if you want to be a good orthodox Marxist, you have to learn and apply Marx's method. And what is Marx's method? Is the method of the classic economic writers like Smith and Ricardo, plus dialectic, plus history, plus the critique, which is the method by which Marx taught how to get rid of the influence of a regressive author. So I wouldn't like to call myself heterodox. I would like to call myself scientific. And I would like to think of myself as somebody who does his best not to get enclosed within any kind of doctrine, but not to reject without seeing what it may give anything.
We'll get the microphone, but maybe also tell that within the different context, I mean, in Latin America and here, things are seen in a very different way also. And you probably did not hear about a book that has just been released in France, a book written by two orthodox economists, just attacking the heterodox one, and the book is called the Economic Negationism. Uh-huh. Okay, so comparing the murder of Jews and the negationism, so the yes. Economic negationism. So if you consider them as scientists, and they consider that the others do not think economy is a science, and I don't think they say science in the way you say. So okay. It's very, very. So words are important.
I want to read it.
Ah, of course.
Thank you.
Wait for me, please.
Of course.
Yes.
First, I want to make sure that you did say the statement, so I do not misinterpret you, that in a capitalist society, there is no democracy, right?
No.
No?
No, I didn't say there is no democracy.
Democracy cannot be embedded in a capitalist society.
The full development and fulfillment of democracy is incompatible with capitalism.
So, yes. So what would you describe what we have right now, if it's not a democracy?
Okay. Is that a question?
Yeah.
I'll go.
Okay.
I'll come back. I said that it's a fake democracy. But fake democracy is not the same as no democracy. And as a matter of fact, I think it's a very big difference. And if we have to fight for this difference, it deserves being defended. Present development of capitalism makes even that fake democracy daily weaker and more impossible. Because a fake needs some kind of performance. Now, this performance to keep the appearance of the modern democratic state is every day more difficult, and the fake is every day less verisimilitude.
So it's worse than no democracy, basically.
Pardon?
It's worse than no democracy.
Yes, yes. So I think we are going towards totalitarianism, and I think that people like this was announced by authors from very different positions, from liberal and from Trotsky himself. It's either socialism or barbarism. I think this is true, and I think that the need for workers' democracy is dramatically urgent, because this fake democracy isn't here to stay, and especially it is not here to improve. Every day you can see that the political ambit in countries where the fake is still visible is poorer and more ineffective. Okay.
My question was about coming back to what Marta was asking about transitions, the transition period.
Yes.
Some of the ideas that you expressed and that the other speakers expressed was that we need this global vision to see how we can transform our society, and that previous efforts were hampered because we used the capitalist way of thinking. We embedded our thinking in this capitalist modality.
Yes.
But there's a whole group of other authors that see things differently. Also Marxian, for example, Alex Williams and
I didn't.
There's a group of Marxian authors. They call themselves the accelerationists. So there's this movement, the accelerationist movement, which says that instead of countering capitalism, we must embrace these capitalist processes, and we must embrace new technologies, and we must accelerate these things so that we can accelerate and affect societal change. Because ultimately, we're looking for a fair and just society, and the global left is too weak to take on this huge, big, strong thing called capitalism. So let's rather embrace it and use capitalism's own tools against itself. What are your thoughts on that?
I'm not sure I got your... Could you put it in
very succinctly. So one of the ideas that you propose is that we are hampered by thinking along capitalist lines.
Yes.
What about if we embrace capitalist thinking? An example is, for example, robotics. Robots taking over jobs and causing unemployment, which is seen as bad for workers. But what if we replace all the workers with robots? Mm-hmm. What if we embrace this thing? Then it means society and governments have to figure out a way to feed people. And well, that will help us create a more fair and just society.
Okay, it's not my line of thought. absolutely. I really never believed it's possible. I'm sure it's not imminent. But the displacement of large multitudes of human beings from civilization has already taken place. This is not a danger, but it's already here, and it's if you can use the word advance, if you can use the word progress, this is what really advances and progresses. Robots have to be designed, have to be made, and robotics is not yet able to replace some human functions, really. The possibility with robotics is extraordinarily desirable, but we have to put this possibility in the context of a socialist society, where the drastic reduction of the working time would permit humans to develop in every dimension as humans and not as robots. Because the problem with robotics is not that robots replace humans, but humans become robots. But coming back to the reduction of the journey, of the working journey, estimates are very difficult to make, but I think we would stand on the safe side of the street if we say that the working journey, if the administration was rationalized in its own terms now, wouldn't be more than half an hour per worker. We could live and thrive with half an hour work, but the rest would, a great part of the rest of the journey, we need to update ourselves to the new knowledges needed not just for reproduction, not just for technology, but for human being, but for being humans. So we wouldn't be missing our work journey. And most of what we do during work journey is not only not useful, but counterproductive, dangerous, and dehumanizing. So I don't see we have to be against robots in any way. I don't say we should love them, but but the idea of robots replacing humans, I think it for the moment really doesn't make sense. It also forms part of a fantasy, which was a very dangerous fantasy during the times where fascism and Nazism and Stalinism were together incubated, which was the break within philosophy of two geological plaques, you say? Plates. One was positivism, which tried to reduce experience to knowledge, and the other one was irrationalism, which tried to reduce knowledge to experience. This schism, I don't know how to pronounce it, schism, is very, very intimately related to the birth of Nazism. Yes. And with it, the revival of myth of archaic cultures, of archaic religions, which are not, which in a capitalist, in a late capitalist context, are not anymore what their name stands for. By definition, that is an anachronism, dangerous, and of the same kind of the revival of the glories of Rome by Mussolini, the revival of the supposed existence of a superior race by Hitler, and the fake of socialism in one country that was another version, but which used the beautiful name of, what was it called? Socialism.
Maybe one last question. We have only 3 to 5 minutes, so one. Where is the microphone? And then you can get his email and
ask. Yes.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Hmm?
Yeah.
Yes, I feel.
Okay. My name is Yasmin. I want to understand your perspective about something. I have read some articles and books as well about the rise and fall of
about
rise and fall of socialism in Latin America. And we see that like countries, for example, like Brazil and Argentina. Countries like Brazil and Argentina, for example, they are now with new governments and embracing more the neoliberalism, which there are studies showing that are really these policies are really damaging the developing countries in general. And even though they continue doing that, at least in my Brazil, in my country, I personally tend to agree more with the named socialist parties because they tend to defend more welfare and more rights for the poorest. However, I don't fully believe that they would be the solution for what we are seeing now in Latin America in general. So I would like to understand your perspective about the current situation and if you think that it's possible a transition for something better or it would be, I don't know, what do you think about that?
Well,
thank you.
It's a hard question to answer. impossible. We should stay for five minutes. Okay. Well, if I want to answer very, very concisely, I will say that even if David was telling us that there is a difference, a big difference from there to here, of course, there are differences, but it's the same society, the same structure, and the same experience is valid. The gist of, I believe, the gist of the recent historical experience is that halfway socialism leads to Nazism. Okay. Am I clear?
Yeah.
Yes. Chavism was halfway socialism. It didn't lead to Nazism because in a weak military, militarily weak country, Nazism stops close. It stops short of what the development, what the outcome of Nazism is, which is war. Chavez and Maduro were unable to raise a war with their neighbors because, they couldn't do that. We won't enter into details. In Brazil, Argentina, Chile, and Uruguay, during the Cold War, the armies were not powerful in international terms. But they were powerful as an inside force, and they stopped very early, they blew down, they murdered the incipient socialist movements, which were already contaminated by Mussolini from the very first start. There were very close relationships between Perón and Mussolini. Personally, Mussolini received Eva Perón as a princess, not as a foreign princess, but as a house princess. And socialism was mixed between two very regressive halfway socialisms. One was Stalinism, and the other one was Peronism in Argentina. In Venezuela, the situation was very different because political parties, which were Acción Democrática and Christian Socialism, I think it's the name in English. They were discredited, absolutely discredited. There was a political vacuum. There were many social conflicts, and Chavez was upheld by the left, by the right, by the firms, by the Americans, by everywhere, because they saw in him somewhat like a political figure that was to play the role that militaries in the 70s had played in the other countries I mentioned. He didn't. This was not his intention. This was not his possibility. But socialism was out of the question. And they did use the name socialism as Holland and as Mussolini, and well, just a bare name means nothing. We have to really give it a new meaning.